Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee. Our first agenda item today is a decision on taking business in private. Is the committee agreed to take item 3 in private? Thank you. Agenda item 2 is the committee is currently conducting an inquiry into the Scottish Government's international work. The aim of this inquiry is to look at how the Scottish Government engages internationally and what it wants to achieve from this work. This includes both its EU and wider international engagement, its support for international development, and how its external affairs policies interact with UK government policies in these areas. And the committee's first panel on this topic, I'm delighted to welcome to committee this morning, Dr. Kirsty Hughes, Fellowship of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, Dr. Adam Marks, International Policy Executive of the Law Society of Scotland, and Professor Murray Pittock, Co-Chair of the Scots Art and Humanities Alliance, the University of Glasgow. Can I thank you also for your submissions before this morning's meeting? We will move directly to questions, and if I could open with a question for everyone, which is around the challenges and risks that the Scottish Parliament face with the post-Brexit situation and TCA governance structures and political and policy dialogue that might result in fewer opportunities for input for devolved institutions than before Brexit. If I could have your reflections on that, and I'll go first to Dr. Hughes, please.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody, and thank you for asking me to give evidence this morning. I think Brexit is obviously a very big change to how the UK's relations with the EU are scrutinised, both here in the Scottish Parliament and elsewhere. And I think it's certainly true, Chair, that it does make it more difficult. And it also, to state the obvious, but it's an important obvious, it means you have to create potentially new processes and new structures. And it also means that it's important that the Scottish Parliament finds a way to have a role in such new structures as are already there or being fleshed out. So obviously we know that the Trade and Cooperation Agreement has a Partnership Council, that it has a whole range of specialised committees, there's a joint parliamentary assembly. We would expect, I'm not sure if the names of the two or three Scottish MPs who are going to be on the joint parliamentary assembly are known yet, but there will be some Scottish ways to input into these things. But it's also important that there are Scottish officials where relevant and obviously in devolved areas on those specialised committees, and then that the Scottish Parliament itself gets feedback on those meetings and on the Scottish Government strategy to engage with the new relationship with the EU, and how the UK government is doing that and how it's relating to the Scottish Government and where the Scottish Parliament fits in that. I think some of this is still processes that are in the making. We saw that Lord Frost did say some time back that, yes, certainly Scottish officials and other devolved administration officials should be involved where relevant in specialised committees and in devolved areas, but we have to make sure that actually happens, and that it happens on a consistent and fair and equal basis. And I think there are also more informal mechanisms. There's the European Parliament has a Friends of Scotland group. The Secretariat for that is provided by the Scottish Government's Brussels office, in fact. So I think it's important that the Scottish Parliament should look at both formal and informal ways of being part of that process. There is more than that one could say, but I think I'll let my other analysts contribute.
Thank you. Dr. Marks?
Yes, I'd agree with almost all of that. I mean, I think it's important to emphasise that the UK government and the Scottish government should maintain as much transparency as possible throughout this process. And as Dr. Hughes has outlined, a lot of this is still in flux at the moment. We do now know some of the structures of the UK-EU TTA, and they are starting to be actually set up and created in a more concrete way rather than just on paper. And to the extent that they then operate, we will have to see how successful they are in the longer term and potentially any problems or not that emerge from it. It's worth just going back slightly and thinking about the sort of the wide ranges of policy area that will overlap with the devolved settlement. And the Cabinet Office, by last count, I think it got to 156 points of areas that were going to overlap with the devolved areas. And how the devolved governments and devolved legislators interact with the various partnership councils, the domestic advisory groups and the civil society forums, all of which Dr. Hughes mentioned, is going to be significant as we go forwards. And certainly I think this committee has a role in scrutinising what those bodies are doing in areas where they impact the devolved settlement. I think in broader terms, we'd look a little bit back to say that some of the structures internally within the UK, we know are under significant challenges, that the JMC, for instance, and we're still waiting to see what happens with Lord Dunlop's proposals for a replacement of that with an intergovernmental council. And again, I think it would be important for MSPs to have a role in how this is structured, and certainly in terms of oversight of that body through this committee. In terms of the Scottish Parliament's role more broadly, I think I'd draw your attention to the recommendations for the legacy report of the Finance and Constitution Committee, which outlined the various areas thematically that the Parliament should be looking at. And I think that was a good start, looking at the areas that were previously of EU competence, the extent to which there is the ability to scrutinise the future relationship with the EU, the keeping pace powers that this Parliament and the government has, the common frameworks and market access principles. And some of this will, of course, come back to information and the awareness of policy that is happening. And again, I think I'd then refer back to some of the comments made about the various institutions the Scottish Government has in Brussels and how much information is going to be fed back via those institutions to government and to yourselves, so that you can then make decisions about what is happening in terms of EU policy currently, and then particularly in relation to the keeping pace power. As my colleagues point out, there is a significant body of EU law that is changing as we speak right now. I believe Strasbourg is in session, presumably passing more of it. And therefore, there is a degree to which there is a need to know what is happening before decisions of scrutiny can be made about what has been done or hasn't been done. I think I'll hand over at that point.
Thank you. Professor Pittock?
Thank you. I think it's clearly important for this committee and for the Scottish Parliament and Scottish officials generally to engage in all the areas where the UK government is engaging and to press for representation in all devolved areas. At the same time, looking at the extent of the overlap of the devolved areas with UK government competences sets up an issue of relevance. Lord Frost is quite happy for relevant participation, but the committee is aware, the IMA really cuts across a very large number of the areas of devolved competence, and so what is or what is not relevant requires persistent scrutiny. I think that scrutiny is also important from the point of view of this committee's role in looking at the Scottish legislation's alignment with EU legislation going forward. And I think when it comes to the importance of actually engaging with the EU directly on that and with policymakers, obviously the hubs abroad, notably the Brussels office, has got a very key role to play. I would say that actually, more broadly speaking, there are areas in education, in climate, in well-being and in the cultural and digital economy where the Scottish Parliament and Scottish government can engage directly with the EU, where there are a lot of ready ears and ready fora in the policy area. And to take one example of that, which is the educational example, there are a large number of federal and confederal Europe-wide bodies involving major Scottish universities. The DIVIS EU Confederation is meeting tomorrow in Brussels, which is the move towards a currently 9, but will be 10 strong confederal European university, which the University of Glasgow is represented in. And although some of the developments recently by the Scottish Government to reinstate student mobility from the EU are very welcome, we're still a very long way from the two-way mobility, which is necessary to support Horizon and other funding bids going forward. That two-way mobility between students and researchers is actually critical to the future engagement of Scotland with the European Union more generally on a policy and on an academic sphere. And the links between the two, I think, should be a particular matter of attention for this committee.
Thank you very much. I'll now move to questions from the committee. Can I remind members, when asking a question, to say who it is for or select which panel member they would like to answer first. And I'll invite Mr. Cameron to invite.
Thank you. Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us. My question, I think, is as a follow-up to some of the comments that have been made in relation to Scotland's relations with the EU. And I think we all accept that even after Brexit, the EU will be a focus for Scotland's international presence. But last week we heard from the Cabinet Secretary that the keeping pace power, for example, hasn't been used and isn't anticipated to be used in the near future. And I just wonder if the panel have any observations about the balance that should be struck between our presence in the EU and more widely. And I think Kirsty Hughes, and if I could come to you first, because I noted that you said you made a comment about this in your in one of your comments, that it's necessary to sort of spread our wings more widely. I hope I'm not mischaracterising you. But I just wondered about balance, particularly because also I think I'm right in saying that the two new international offices that are proposed are in Warsaw and Copenhagen, which is obviously within the EU. And, you know, I suppose I'm asking, is have we got the balance right here?
I certainly agree with you that it's important that there is a strong focus on Scotland-EU relations. Your comment on keeping pace not being used, I think, takes us on to another issue that maybe we'll come back to later. But I think, as you know, there are other ways than the keeping pace powers to actually stay abreast of some EU laws, and it's extremely important that that's done in a transparent way and that the Scottish Parliament can scrutinise that. A couple of comments on the heart of your question, though, which is about the EU international balance. Firstly, I think one of the challenges post-Brexit, and it's a challenge at UK as well as at Scotland level, is politicians and officials are no longer in the room, and there were very, very many rooms. You know, if you try to count how many council working groups and European Parliament meetings there were in any week, there are dozens in Brussels, Strasbourg and elsewhere. So we're not just thinking of not being at big European summits. And of course, there's also lots of informal networking and discussion around those meetings. So we're outside the room looking in, and that means we have to work harder to maintain contacts, to get some but not as much information as we had before, and to try and be influential when that's in our interests. So, of course, there are limited resources, and the question is how you prioritise them. But in terms of that impact of Brexit, that in itself would make a case for more focus, I think, on Europe. And then, of course, so we will come on to this, and it's in the evidence and in the questions, but the EU and the EEA remains Scotland's biggest trade partner if you include the EFTA countries. Just over 50% of Scotland's trade is with the EU and EFTA countries, and there are also geographically close and in many ways sympathetic, if that's the right word, or reasonably closely aligned to some of Scottish and UK policy interests and priorities, for instance, in the area of climate. And you know, if you look at the planned new hub in Copenhagen, for instance, as I understand it, that's meant to also have a regional focus, not only meant to focus on Denmark. So to me, that one particularly makes sense in terms of trying to increase the geographical range in the EU. I also think, and it's not clear to me that this is the view of the Scottish government or not. The Scottish government has a so-called international relations strategy. I think it needs a new assessment. It's not very strategic. It's not very coherent, and I'm not quite sure how long it's been there. I would say that Europe probably needs to be at the heart of that international strategy, but then you need to, in a sense, put your policy priorities across your geographical priorities, and then see where that takes you in terms of whether your other international offices that obviously already are there need to be further expanded, or whether they can be adequately serviced from the small number that already exist. I think that, you know, there is obviously a problem or a risk of being too thinly spread, but I also think we see it everywhere. We see cities engage internationally, we see regions engage internationally, we see sub-states engage internationally. So certainly there's a case also to be international, but I think it makes perfect sense to put Europe at the core of that. And I think that's not what the UK government has done. So in terms of potential differences between Scottish government and UK government approaches, that might be one to look at. But I would personally, my view would be that the UK government should put the EU more, despite Brexit, more at the heart of its international and so-called global Britain policies. Thank you.
Do any of the other panellists want to come in on that?
Yes, I wouldn't mind, and I think that's it's an excellent question, because I think, Deputy Convener, because what lies behind it is a question about strategy. And I think that if you look at the overall footprint of the Scottish Government overseas, among sub-state actors, the budget devoted to its overseas representation is not particularly high, though comparatively speaking, it's a relatively modest overseas presence. But I think one of the questions you're raising is that of a strategic, and there in Kirsty's answer too, is that of the strategic priorities. And obviously the EU and interaction with the EU, for the reasons that Kirsty outlined, is a strategic priority. There are other strategic areas like diaspora connections, where there's actually a significant overlap with the UK's Global Britain agenda, and there are trade priority areas too. I think what we don't yet see is a strategy which clearly marks the key EU diasporic and trade partners. And there's also within the EU particularly areas where that element of Scottish branding I alluded to in my first response is also critical. For example, the climate strategies linked to Nordic and Arctic policy, which is where the hub in Copenhagen makes particular sense. So I think that it's not a particularly heavily funded international terms strategy. It's not perhaps absolutely yet a completely clear strategy, but its focal points and what it should focus on are, I think, very clear, and some of them are extremely well served by the existing and planned hubs.
Thank you, Dr. Marks. Thanks.
Thank you. And thank you for that question. I think it's an important one, and as the previous answers have alluded to, there is an overall strategy question here to be looked at. I think
it is worth thinking about how the UK and the Scottish Government work together in terms of wider UK trade strategy and how Scotland fits into that strategy. In particular, I'm thinking about the UK's move towards things like CPTPP, and it's looking at trade deals out with Australia and New Zealand and how that is going to fit. I also think there has to be a realism about what can be achieved with, as people said, relatively limited resources. And the reality is that I would suggest that the smaller countries and parts of countries that have been quite successful with their engagement abroad have picked topics and, you know, focused on those. I think the keeping pace power, it's an interesting question about how much it will be and won't be used and how much time that is going to take. But there is an inevitability that working with the EU is going to remain important. I would also emphasise, I think some of the EEA countries in Switzerland are as well useful to be working with, since they share, again, some of the similar issues to which the UK and Scotland will in terms of their relations with the EU. Norway in particular has been very good at working out how to engage in Brussels, and even looking sort of slightly more broadly afield, who was talking about sort of the importance of being aware of policy developments. Areas like Bavaria have done very well at informing both people within Germany and in Bavaria itself, and indeed in Brussels as well, about what it is that matters to them. And I think, you know, organisations such as Scotland House can seek to emulate such models as they go forwards.
Thank you for those answers. Can I just pick up on something that Dr. Marx said in his last comments, which is, you know, how does Scottish government policy interact with UK government policy, which is in fact one of the issues at the heart of this inquiry. As we know, international relations is a reserved matter under the Scotland Act, and yet I think we all accept that it's important Scotland has an international presence. Most of the international offices, I think I'm right in saying, are located within UK embassies. Can I ask the panel, what's best practice here? How does Scottish government policy best interact with UK government policy when it comes to international relations? What are the pitfalls? What are the flashpoints? And if I could go to Dr. Marx first.
Yeah. So again, thank you for the question. I would sort of following on from what I was saying, really, I think the importance here is going to be transparency between both sides. I think the importance is going to be identifying areas where there can be work done together. And as you say, whilst it's important to acknowledge the limitations of what can be done by the Scottish Government under the devolution settlement, it's also important to acknowledge that Scottish ministers will be responsible for the implementation of international agreements, just as they were responsible for the implementation of EU law in the past. I think this is one where the challenges at the moment politically between the various governments and the various devolved legislators make this perhaps a little difficult to see. But as we move forwards, I would hope that more formal structures can come back into the fore. And again, I think some of this comes down to sort of more broader intergovernmental structures, and of which foreign affairs and international affairs will inevitably become a part. I think the Scottish Government's work out with those structures should take into account the framework of what the UK is doing. And again, there should be transparency about what that is to both this committee and indeed to the UK government. Things like the Friends of Scotland group, for instance, that Scottish governments could meet with to try and influence the European Parliament. This is something that, again, Norwegians have done very effectively, trying to influence the European Parliament. I think that's the sort of good work that should be done. I also think that it needs to be done in a way that is coordinated with a whole UK approach, a process which has to cut both ways. Both the UK has to take into account the devolution settlement, and the devolved governments must have to take into account what UK government wider policy is. And I think I'll hand over to others at that point.
Do Professor Pittock or Kirsty Hughes want to come in here? Professor Pittock?
Thank you. So I think to answer your question directly, I think the great advantage here is to extend the range of the team, as it were, which can be cut, because there is a very strong resonance for the Scottish voice abroad, and that in many cases aids the UK voice. The flashpoints and pitfalls, I think, really are, and I think all the hubs are very, very aware of this, these issues, are policy discussions overseas in reserved areas, and particularly the discussion of anything explicitly political, which might occur within the context of a British embassy. I have to say, even those, in my experience, even those hubs which are not in British embassies are very diplomatic when it comes to including the British government. For example, the Scotland in Europe document launched at the Rockland House in London was very carefully included Caroline Wilson, at that stage head of European affairs, now, of course, UK ambassador to China, and other UK government representatives. So I think that practice here is often very secure, and more secure than sometimes the way in which it's discussed. And there's a good awareness that there and good integration in the hubs which do work inside British embassies, particularly, for example, in until recently, I'm not saying anything's really have declined at all, but John Webster's role as a UK diplomat moving to the Scottish hub in Dublin made relations particularly good there. An example of good practice, I think, currently is the work that the Scottish Government and the Department of International Trade are doing on the Dubai Expo, with five separate Scottish days, the first the Scottish Space Day, and the launch of the Scottish Space Strategy, very effective, good coverage in CNN, and a really high level of global recognition coming from that. And DIT and the Scottish Government working very well together there. So I think the issue is here that informally the flashpoints are very well recognised on both sides, and it's actually getting a wider formal understanding of that. Because I'm not aware that any Scottish Government hub has any interest, and particularly warns people off if they should be think about it, explicit political events or policy discussions which touch on reserved business.
And Kirsty Hughes?
You talk about, in international relations or foreign policy, yes, is reserved, but a wider acceptance that of course, Scotland has an external affairs policy and Holly Rood a committee. I think what's interesting is if you look bluntly at where the UK government and Scottish government disagree, if I was writing a comment piece or even a research paper, you can make that look quite stark. Obviously, the UK government was in favour of Brexit. Brexit has happened. The Scottish government was opposed to it. It wanted a softer Brexit as a compromise in the single market. That didn't happen. I think the First Minister said the other day that the UK government shouldn't trigger Article 16 in the discussions over the Northern Ireland Protocol. The long-run aim of the Scottish government is independence in the EU. The Scottish government wants to keep pace with EU law in devolved areas, and clearly that's not an aim of the UK government. But I think it's worth setting that out, those political differences, because then when you say, well, but how does that actually impact on UK or Scotland international relations, strategy, policy, behaviour, I think we'd have to say not that much. Whether it's helpful or unhelpful for the First Minister from the UK government point of view to say, don't trigger Article 16. I think Brussels knows who it's negotiating with on that. Whether or not and how much Scotland does keep pace with EU laws, whether that clashes with the Internal Market Act is more a question of internal UK debate and dispute. So in a way, I see some of the differences that are obviously and starkly there are just part of the fact of having devolved structures, administrations, parliaments and so forth. And if you look at one more contrast here. At the moment, relations between the EU and UK are in a pretty bad place. Trust in the UK government from the EU side is extremely low. I did a paper on this a year ago, doing a lot of off-the-record so-called elite interviews, looking at how different EU actors and member states viewed the UK and also viewed Scotland. And Scotland was viewed much more positively. Seems to me, in a period of bad UK-EU relations, and we all have our views on what that looks like and why it's there, it's not bad that Scotland and perhaps other devolved administrations have better relations with the EU. It's like a multi-track paradiplomatic process, maybe. And when we get to the nitty-gritty, as my fellow panellists have been talking about this morning, when you think about climate change or wanting overall good relations with the EU or wanting good trade relations with the EU despite the barriers of Brexit, wanting to do joint research with the EU, I think when you get onto the nitty-gritty or also onto the big principles around human rights, multilateralism, democracy, you're actually going to find a similarity. So I don't think, interestingly, despite those differences, I don't think there are necessarily big clashes. I think as both Dr. Marx and Professor Pittock have said, we need to sort out better the structures for intergovernmental relations. If you look at the 2013 memo of understanding, the Concordat, I think a lot of what it says on why and how devolved administrations in Scotland can and should engage in international relations and through and with the UK government is very good, but it obviously needs updating, and it was drawn up at a time when we were still in the EU. And my last brief comment there, I mean, I've been to the hubs in Berlin and Paris. The Berlin one sits directly in the embassy. My impression from talking to people both in the hubs and in the embassy, I didn't get any sense of friction. There's a lot, as you know, a lot of cultural work going on, some very interesting work around economy, technology, things like hydrogen. And I think building up those relations over time, the huge value of having even a small number of people on the ground, because these hubs are very small, I think it is already clearly demonstrable. So I think the questions are acute and important, and I'm not trying to say there won't ever be flashpoints when you look at what I've outlined as the differences. But equally, when you try and pin it down and say, well, does the UK government want good or bad relations with the EU? Obviously, it wants good relations, one assumes, and therefore there's not a problem that actually at the moment the Scottish government does have those good relations. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Boyack.
Thanks very much, Convener, and welcome to the witnesses this morning. Very keen to follow up the comments that we've received from lots of organisations in writing about the Scottish Government's international and development strategy, and it's been picked up by yourselves this morning about the need to be more coherent and more strategic. So I would be very keen to get your views on what the priorities should be. EU is important both economically and culturally, given our relations historically and the issue of international trade, its importance. But I was wondering if you would want to talk about how we prioritise across the range of issues that you've all mentioned, whether it's soft power and culture, our economic interests, and then the post-COP challenge in terms of acting on climate change. So, and the point just made there by Kirsty Hughes about human rights. So just thinking through what you think more needs to be done to be focusing on priorities that should be there for the Scottish Government, given that the resources are relatively limited in terms of the overall budget. And maybe come to you, Kirsty Hughes, first.
I think it's a good question, and it's always an extremely hard one to answer when you are talking about limited resources. But of course, when we're looking at the Scottish Government's European strategy, we're not only talking about the hubs and the Brussels office. You've got groups or units or whatever the correct term is of officials in the civil service here in Scotland who are obviously working on and coordinating European affairs. So my impression is that there is a fairly coherent structure at the moment in terms of fitting the hubs into those wider European strategy bodies, and the overall European strategy being coordinated jointly out of Edinburgh and Brussels at that senior level. I think that's good, but I think what you need more of, and it's easy to say and it's never easy to do, but I mean, one thing that policy experts and academics will always tell you is that there's no clear dividing line between domestic and international policy, and that's pretty obvious in terms of things like climate change and trade. But therefore, the question is, how do you mainstream your international and European strategy across all your departments, all your cabinet, all your officials? And I'm not sure how well that's being done. And that comes back to my sense that there is a better European strategy at the moment than there is an international strategy. And as I said in answer to an earlier question, I think those two need to go together. So I think that's one issue. I think you're right. It's easy to come up with a list of maybe, you know, 10 priorities, but actually listening to the committee's questions and to my fellow witnesses this morning, you know, some of the most obvious and biggest are coming up again and again. That's climate change and trade and education and research networks. I think one thing that hasn't come up that we should add in here is EU citizens in Scotland. You know, the contributions they're making and how they fit into and relate to the importance of good relations with the EU. International development, obviously, Scotland's a small player in international development. UK is larger and the EU is extremely large. So I think the question there, it comes back to what something Dr. Mark said in an earlier question. It's about focus. If you focus, is there a way where you can actually develop particular expertise, particular best practice, and so although you're a relatively small actor, that you do make a contribution. I also think, to my last point here, you have to think about principles and priorities, or if you like, principles and interests. So it's not that human rights or multilateralism should just be one of your 10 priorities. That should surely be the framework within which you then do, whether it's climate change, trade, international development, youth, education, or other issues as your priorities. So, I also think it doesn't have to be identical, and this is the advantage of hubs. You want a clear strategic guide for Scottish government's work as a whole, but there may be very specific things on the ground. And if the Berlin hub is talking to German businesses and researchers about hydrogen technology, it doesn't automatically mean that would make sense for the Copenhagen and Paris hubs as well. So I think within any strategy, you're always going to be mixing the specific and the priorities. But that's why the more it's very clearly structured across these different components of values, interests, priorities, and specific areas within that, that not only helps it have more impact, it actually also, of course, helps coordination, it helps reporting back, which ought to help if there's a clear strategy, accountability and transparency back to the Scottish Parliament.
Thank you. And Professor Pittock, you made some points about both culture and education. I was wondering how you saw that fitting into the priorities in terms of the Scottish Government's work on international development.
Thank you. I think that what I would call overall brand, and I have called that in the response, is very important. And by brand, I certainly mean things like the Scottish Government's reputation and Scotland's reputation in climate, digital, progressive and humanitarian legislation, and the digital and cultural economy in particular, where I lead the work stream for the Scottish Arts Humanities Alliance. But also, I mean that actually Scotland's got a strong brand abroad. Its brand is actually very nostalgic. It's principally a couple of hundred years old in terms of its perception. And there's relatively poor recognition, both in the Anholt and the British Council data, of Scotland's cutting-edge position in science as one of the most cited countries in the world per capita. But I think one of the things that was really, really useful in the hubs in recent years was the presentation in Scotland House, London, which supported the Strength in Places funding for translational medicine in Scotland. And by putting the bid in front of some of the major players in a context, a London context, who could be reached there, who couldn't be reached in a Scottish context. So I think actually promoting cutting-edge research is a key element in what should be done, because that's part of actually building a very different vision of Scotland from, praiseworthy as it is, you know, castle, mountains, heather and whisky. So brand is really important, thought of as a complete entity, including contemporary research. Trade is very important, and the matrix of both of those things is the EU and the diaspora. Where are the strongest links that cross over between brand and trade, their EU and the EU and the diaspora locations? So those, out of that, I think it's pretty clear to make a set, a very clear overarching set of strategic priorities. Though, as Kirsty rightly says, those will have operational variations in different countries.
Thanks. That's very, very useful. I'm thinking also about the forward development partner countries. How do they fit into that strategy, where maybe it's more climate support, particularly post-COP, and thinking about supporting civic groups? That's one of the issues raised by the groups from Malawi.
Yeah, so I think that this actually, the research sector fits there very well. I mean, Scottish, to take Malawi as an example, Scottish universities, for example, this goes back more than 20, 25 years, Strathclyde, but other universities too, have been engaged in infrastructure development, in education opportunity in Malawi. And I think the issue is that some of these developments with the development target countries could take place across government and the higher education sector more formally, and with greater publicity as there being a cooperative effort. So I think that actually they fit in very nicely to one aspect of what I've been discussing. And of course, the more one engages at this kind of level, the more soft power and positive sentiment towards the relationship develops.
Thanks. And Dr. Marks, did you have a comment about the issue of priorities and the strategic approach to be effective across, thinking about both the European connection, but how you prioritise the rest of the world and where the four partner countries fit in there?
I think in the broader strategic process, I'd have to have some thoughts, which, I mean, for the moment at least, that the issue is that we are very much in a state of transition. Yes, the Brexit process has ended formally, but in the wider sense of foreign affairs, although it seems like we've all been talking about Brexit for a long time, we are still explaining to the rest of the world where we fit into it in that. And I think that is a UK and a Scottish project, and I think that fits with a post-COP, trying to explain what the UK's priorities are in that, and indeed where Scotland is going to fit within that with other partner countries. I think in broader terms, I'd also emphasise that sort of the rise in prominence of trade policy and trying to explain where trade policy fits and how trade policy fits into the work of almost every committee within, say, the Scottish Parliament, and certainly almost all of the ones in the UK Parliament as well. This is an issue which, although it is sometimes rather difficult and close and technical to explain, it's also an issue that can become very high level and high profile. Even before 2016, things like TTIP and ACTA definitely motivated large numbers of people, as I'm sure elected representatives will remember from the state of their inboxes at the time. So I think there is an active interest out there, which can be used perhaps for more useful reasons. In terms of focus, I think there's an issue, and it was one of the other questions that was asked about sort of geography versus thematically. And I think from our side, I would say thematically to a degree makes more sense, because you have to pick the sort of topics that you want, be they climate change, be they whatever it is that you choose. Those are areas then you can work across multiple places, and then this is again where coordination with the UK government and Scottish government becomes quite important, which, as other panelists have pointed out, can work quite well. I mean, soft power, for instance, you know, Burns Night Suppers you know, despite what has just been said, are highly effective ways of doing this. And Bavaria, for all of its reputation of being a high-tech hub, still does Oktoberfest events the world over, and would dearly love to have Bern suppers as well, I'm sure. So I think, you know, it's about picking the focus and then working effectively as we can across that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Could bring in Mr. Ruskell, please.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I was just listening to all those comments, and I was struck by what Dr. Hughes was saying about this sort of multi-track paradiplomatic process, and where perhaps sub-state legislatures, governments can kind of fit with that alongside the actions of states as well. I wondered if you had more sort of examples of that. And one which sprung to my mind was, I understood from a discussion with a Canadian mission in Brussels that there'd been quite a lot of bilateral discussions between Quebec and Wallonia during the talks on the CETA trade agreement. But I wondered if you had examples of where those kind of sub-state actors can be involved in a wider multilateral discussion and that might point to how Scotland could be involved with the UK.
Do you want to answer first? Or?
Well, could I start with Dr. Hughes on that one, and if others would like to comment on that, and then I'll move on to another question.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. It's another good question. You've already given the example of Quebec, which does have an office in Brussels. I actually think, well, we've also already mentioned Bavaria, and most of the, if not all of the German regions or Länder have offices in Brussels, and they're very important and powerful. Norway is not a sub-state, it's a state, but, you know, it has a very, very big office in Brussels. So I think, in fact, you know, we could look at various examples, but I would urge you not to only look at sub-state examples, because you may be able to learn from what's going on with city networks. You may be able to learn from what's happening with states like Norway. And I think what's also very interesting is actually there's a lot to be learned from small states within the EU. I was doing a research project, produced a paper on small states within the EU a year and a half ago, and that may seem quite a long way from Scotland as a sub-state outside the EU. But what's fascinating about what the smaller states in the EU do is, apart from that they are in the room and they have a seat at all the tables, they do an enormous amount of informal networking and lobbying, building long-run alliances, looking for areas of common interest, whether it's on climate or trade or tech or something else. When you ask diplomats and others from those countries what their priorities and tactics are, they talk about getting in early when a new and important policy issue is being discussed, looking for compromises, being very aware of other allies' interests and needs, so that if you're in the EU and maybe you're Ireland, you may not be as worried about the EU's eastern frontier as Poland is, but there's a bit of reciprocity and give and take. So not all those lessons will go across, but I think quite a lot of those lessons will go across. So, I mean, I think that's one point. Yes, there's a lot of this at sub-state level, and it could be interesting to investigate that more, though there have been some research papers done on that. I think the other thing that could be very helpful, it's come up again and again this morning, that there are a whole range of Scottish civil society networks or participation in networks that may be universities, it's business, it's NGOs, it's all sorts of groups, and by definition those are not governmental bodies. But is the Scottish Government and is the Scottish Parliament sure it's across all those networks? They're very, very dense, and it's easy to pick out some of the big and main ones, but it could potentially be a really useful piece of work, I think, to try and elaborate in greater detail what that full range of networks are. So, sorry, I've gone a bit more broadly than just your question, but I think that point about there are so many layers and levels that could be engaged with. And again, of course, it will come back to the question of priorities. Well, here's 200 ways, but what are your top four? And what are the most, you know, are the most interesting sub-states for Scotland ones inside the EU, even though we no longer are, or is it ones in the EFTA countries, so Geneva or North Norway, or what is there to learn from something like Quebec? Also, what is there to learn if you look at Ireland, you know, which is a core EU member state, it's in the euro, it's very committed to its European relationships, but it also has a clear and distinct global foreign policy, despite being a smaller country. How does it interact, that foreign policy, with its EU policy, and how does it, for instance, make choices internationally when it's small? So I think, not to be too nervous of learning from states as well as sub-states.
It's obviously a complex landscape, many different rooms in Brussels to be in or out of. Can I ask then Dr. Marx and then Professor Pittock, same question.
Yeah, I'd echo a lot of this. I think the key point I'd make is that the UK and Scottish government's work can very much complement each other. And I think that's important to emphasise throughout this. You know, Quebec, Wallonia, Bavaria, all the examples, you know, they do their own work, they do their own policies, but it very much complements what else is being done. I mean, Quebec, for instance, picked the priorities it was particularly interested in, which was CETA as a trade deal, for obvious reasons. Also, it was part of the negotiating sense of how Canada is federally set up. But beyond that, they have then also chosen other priorities. So, for example, particular AI was one that they identified earlier on, and they've been observers on various high-level expert groups from the European Commission, which is the sort of thing that could be looked at as strategies which would then complement well with what the UK government is doing. I would emphasise that sort of for this to work, this needs a sort of an atmosphere of trust and cooperation, which we've already discussed at some length. But I think transparency goes some ways to helping this, and I think this is where conversations need to be had in public and through the various bodies that exist for that to happen, and possibly some others, to enable everybody to be aware of what everyone's doing. And this then also feeds into the broader points of civil society. But if civil society know what is happening, then they too can engage, which even further broadens the pool of people who are looking to contribute and help and focus on these objectives. Again, it's the picking the objectives, which I accept is going to be the very difficult part of this. Thank you.
Professor Pittock.
Thank you. Well, I think that, for example, at the UK-Canada annual colloquium this year, there was very full representation from the Canadian provinces, not just Quebec, in terms of the discussion of policy formulation within Canada. So I think that there are other states are very well aware of this kind of balance, and obviously the Scottish government was represented from the UK. If we're to look, there are a whole range of issues in the sub-state area here, from the extent of Flanders' comprehensive range of domestic institutions, and a great deal of discussion in terms of developing or augmenting current Scottish institutions could usefully take place in a Flemish context, to the fact that Bavaria, while very geared towards the overall and aligned with the overall aspects of the Federal Republic, has for many years, for over 50 years, put pressure on the Federal Republic, for example, on immigration in the 1960s and 70s, when it felt that the alignment was not working in its interests. So there is the alignment is not a one-way street. Alignment is also a negotiation. I would also stress that, I mean, I mentioned the EU Civis network already, confederal network, but that's got to focus on large cities. So the EU is very aware itself that large cities, global cities, and often the institutions that are, not least higher education institutions, are the major drivers of economic growth. And so we can't overlook the large city tier. And in terms of joint working with states, I haven't mentioned yet the bilateral review with Ireland, the implementation of which stretches to the next Irish government review of its international strategy in 2025. But clearly, that bilateral review showed that there were significant areas of commonality in the diaspora and elsewhere between the Scottish government and state governments. And the same applies in the Arctic with Iceland and elsewhere. So I think it's a three-layer level of engagement. There is a state engagement which is transparent and doesn't not constitutionally or threatening in terms of reserved powers, but is where their common interests. There's a sub-state agreement, but a level of engagement. But I think that also means that there has to be a greater transparent understanding about how sub-state and state relationships work elsewhere in global terms. And that actually came to some extent out of the Canada colloquium this year, but could profitably come out of a number of the EU sub-state organisations. And there's also the global cities issue. And I don't think that Scottish Government representation or policy can afford to lose sight of any of those three interlocutors.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Just one follow-up question, Convener. And I was reading the Law Society's submission, and you know, you're making the point about there needs to be some formal mechanisms for monitoring our international engagement. I mean, given that very potentially quite complex picture that you've just outlined, what do you think that should look like? And I think you'd suggested, Dr. Marks, a kind of memorandum of understanding between Scottish Government and ourselves in the Scottish Parliament. And I guess it's this sense of how can we get a grip of what that work looks like. I mean, I'm not suggesting a list of every single burn supper that's taken place, every single hub. That might be a bit too much. But, you know, in terms of scrutiny, what do you think those formal mechanisms should look like? So if I can go to Dr. Marks, and if the other panellists have got anything to add on that, that'd be useful.
Yeah, absolutely happy to. And I think the important thing to emphasise is that this is, as we've discussed, something that would have to evolve as time went on and evolve to the needs and response to policy as it happens. But I think at the bare minimum, looking for some sort of commitment to regular and scheduled evidence sessions to this committee and other relevant committees from ministers, where they have actually, you know, engaged abroad and on areas that are relevant to the Scottish Parliament. Some sort of commitment to reporting. I mean, I agree every single burn supper may not be necessarily the requirement. So the line and threshold of what needs to be reported is one that would require careful thought. But reporting of meetings, reporting of what is being done. Again, this would have to take into account some confidentiality for commercial reasons, if nothing else, potentially. Again, I would refer back to my previous statement that the transparency is the friend of much of this process, but that there will always be some limits. I think also, as I've said before, some sort of commitment to keeping the Parliament up to date on EU law developments as they are happening would be useful, particularly to this committee, so it can assess what is happening. And then obviously the wider things, sort of the, you know, the budget process would presumably take care of what we currently have now in terms of, you know, paying for the foreign affairs as it is done by the Scottish Government. But again, scrutiny of that is always welcome. And potentially, and again, the final most difficult part of this as part of it would be something to acknowledge how it would fit with the other intergovernmental structures within the UK, which obviously, except at the moment, would be a challenging part to write. But I think that would be a starting point as far as I could see. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
OK, thanks. I don't know if any of the other panellists have got a reflection on that. Yeah, Dr. Hughes.
Yeah, thank you. Just briefly, I agree with what Dr. Marks has said. I think scrutiny is important, both in and of itself. We need transparency and accountability, but I think it's come up repeatedly this morning that we do need more coherence in international policy, more clarity, both in itself as Scotland and in how that relates to UK government actions and so I think a regular and I think a reasonably detailed reporting agreement of some sort would be beneficial, and you know, we can smile at whether we want to know how many burn suppers there are, but frankly one assumes that the hubs are indeed reporting back to the European directors within the civil service. So actually if we know whether there were 5 or 55 burn suppers, that's actually perfectly easy to, or ought to be, to put on a list of reporting. I think we've not spent too much time on the keeping pace process this morning, but it is nonetheless an aim of the Scottish Government, you know, to align in devolved areas to EU laws. And as I said earlier, that doesn't have to be done through keeping pace legislation. It can be done through other legislative routes. But since it's actually a rather important strategic, I'd say, aim, I would be asking and trying to agree with the Scottish Government that all aspects of aligning with EU laws, and I'm trying not to use the keeping pace word so it encompasses other ways of doing this, that there is proper and full reporting on that. And also what I understand is that where there have been so far some efforts to align with EU laws, it's not necessarily complete alignment, though there may be a new EU law and there's an agreement on, well, the goal is X in some specific environment goal, for instance, but we don't have to achieve it in exactly the way they are doing so in the EU, because we're no longer in the EU and because businesses might find it easier to do it in another way. That raises some very interesting questions. You know, is the aim to stay as aligned as possible, because perhaps at some future point, Scotland and the rest of the UK might rejoin even the single market, or just that there are benefits of being exactly aligned so that you can minimise some of the Brexit regulatory barriers? Or is it just a kind of general good intention? Now, we could have multiple reports and evidence sessions on that, but I think it's a fundamental question. And so that should be there when considering what sort of agreement might be feasible and what the Scottish Government should indeed be really making clear to the Scottish Parliament.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. Thank you. Could I move on to questions from Ms. Minto, please?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel. I'd like to explore a bit more the education side and the connections both across Europe and also the diaspora. Professor Pittock, you talked about the two-way movement of students, and I was very struck when I visited SAMHS in my constituency about 10 days ago about the impact of their student numbers. Also, the Law Society talked about broadening horizons of our own students, and then also the research side as well. So I'd just like to hear some further thoughts and reflections on how the Scottish Government can work to improve these links. Perhaps Dr. Marks, we'll start with you.
I'm happy to. I think to some extent it's a little bit difficult to comment too much on where we're going, because the Turing scheme isn't particularly bedded in, but we welcome efforts to try to replace the Erasmus scheme as was. Certainly we know that a large number of lawyers did take advantage of it over its existence. We also welcome the Saltire scheme from the Scottish Government, which is trying to very much support people inside there. I think I would also feed your question into some of the general networks which have been alluded to elsewhere in terms of how we coordinate with the profession across Europe. So, for instance, in our case, the Law Society of Scotland is maintaining an affiliate membership with the Council of Bars and Law Societies of Europe. This was negotiated after the Brexit process, and this was very much reached alongside the rest of the UK delegation, so that we have some voting rights on issues of importance, but not voting rights to us, but not voting rights on issues relevant to EU law. And I think sort of that sort of networking will feed into the wider sort of educational aspects, where lawyers work, where lawyers will liaise with and work with, and those are the sort of networks that we need to now work harder than ever to maintain. There are also, as I've said, some of these parts of the networks, which, as with much of it, is bedding in at the moment. It is a very new status for all of us and will require close attention and work, and potentially we'll have more idea about how successful much of this is in, you know, 5 years' time, 10 years' time than we do now. Thank you.
It's positive to hear that that work's going ahead, and I think it's very important, not only from a legislation perspective, but also understanding the legal side and the human rights side of things as well. And from my own previous background as an accountant as well, keeping consistency of policies across that area. Dr. Hughes, could you comment, please?
Well, I only have a little to add. I think it was extremely disappointing that the UK government chose not to continue to participate in the Erasmus programme, when you look at the decision to stay associated with the Horizon Research Programme but not with the Erasmus programme, it looks to my mind rather ideological, and it clearly restricts opportunities for young people. And I think everything we've said this morning, in a sense, is about how do we preserve, protect, develop, create our European and international networks. You know, and Scotland is a European country. You don't have to be in the EU to be a European country. So I think, you know, all the things that Dr. Marx has just talked about, and the Saltire scheme, we'll see how the Turing scheme works, but it's clearly not the same as the Erasmus scheme. It may be that the UK government in the future might change its mind on Erasmus, but for the moment we are where we are. So I think whatever can be done to mitigate the impacts of Brexit and keep those sorts of opportunities open is important. And that maybe links back to what I was saying before about the better and more detailed the picture there is of the range of civil society, including business participation and networking and all the city and sub-state networks we've been talking about across Europe, may also give rise to new ideas of new ways of building on the basics as offered by the Saltire and Turing schemes.
Thank you. And Dr. Pittock, have you anything to add? I know you've already expanded on education, but you may have something further to add.
Well, I think I do have something further to add, actually, as the sole representative of the higher education sector here, which is that Scotland was the number one recipient of Erasmus students. There were 2,904 in 2019. 67% of those students studied arts and humanities. That data is from the British Academy's report in 2021. So we've got a very large chunk of people who are not being replaced by, welcome as it is, the current Saltire schemes. We've also got a situation where the Welsh Government are currently investing a very substantial sum of money, over £100 million over the period to 2025, in replicating a two-way Erasmus scheme with European partners. And what I would stress is that welcome as it is to bring students from the EU to Scotland, and that's a very important part of our dialogue, if we don't send people out, if we do not have a two-way exchange process, then we are not getting the benefits which the Erasmus scheme introduced in 1987 originally set up. And particularly, we're not getting the dialogue with European civic institutions, with European research institutions, with European universities, and with the Horizon Network, if indeed we fully affiliate, the UK fully affiliates to it in an appropriate way, which can develop research funding, research capacity, and also the understandings which came through the very significant proportion of Erasmus bilateralism that went to internships, work placements, and so forth. So currently, it's great we've made some progress. It's rather remarkable that more progress has been made in Cardiff than Edinburgh, significantly more progress. And the lack of bilateralism is a real problem. And Turing is not a bilateral scheme either. So without bilateralism, we don't get exchanges. And we've already seen that the current regulations on European ID cards are keeping 80% plus of school trips out of the UK, and that includes Scotland from continental Europe. So that all these things, from European pen pals to friends, to students, to business, to research exchanges, all these things are being adversely affected in a way which is, of course, currently entirely retrievable, but which will tend to a decay in appropriate bilateral relationships over time. And a sustained bilateral support for educational movement is a significant part of that.
Thank you very much, Professor Pittock. Can I move on to a slightly different subject, completely different subject, I suppose. 2 weeks ago, Glasgow hosted COP26, really the centre of the international world. I'd just be interested on your thoughts and reflections of the impact of COP26 on Scottish international development. Perhaps start with Dr. Hughes.
Sorry, when you say Scottish International Development, you mean Scotland International Relations?
Or yes, you mean yes, absolutely, sorry. Countries? Yes, right. Exactly.
I think well done such sort of big and vital global events can obviously be very positive to the host country. And I think from what I saw, Scotland and the Scottish government, but also a whole range of, you know, other actors and NGOs, civil society and so on, or business too, all took great advantage of that. And I think, as I've mentioned earlier today, there are more positive views, especially in the EU, but to some extent internationally, of the Scottish government at the moment than there are of the UK government. And I think we can all see why that is in terms of the way the Brexit process has unfolded. And I don't think it's good that UK and international views of the UK government are where they are, but I think wherever views of the UK government are, it's obviously in Scotland's interest that its government, even if you're an opposition politician, that, you know, that its government has good international relations and that reflects positively on the country as a whole. There's more serious issues here in terms of what COP did and didn't achieve, the climate emergency, and what happens next. I think that does again though underline the importance of European relations for all some of the weaknesses in the EU's climate positions. It's one of relatively speaking the climate leaders in the world, and Scotland has its own challenges around climate policy and a just transition from North Sea oil and gas, but also much to offer in terms of sustainable, renewable energy. So I think whether one's thinking of it in terms of soft power diplomacy or actual engagement with the crucial issue of the climate emergency, I think in that sense, I think it reflected well on Scotland.
Thank you. I was kind of building on the ideas from Professor Pittock about relationships and the sharing of knowledge and that side of things as well. So I don't know if the other two panellists would like to comment at all. Professor Pittock, no?
I simply agree, but I think one of the things that came out of it was that actually, although it appeared that the UK and Scottish governments might not work well together in the run-up to COP, they did work well together at COP, and that actually perhaps even more could have been achieved if there'd been less politics earlier on, though I know politics is inevitable, but actually it was a success for cooperation in the end.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can we move to questions from Dr. Allen, please?
Thank you very much. Questions for Professor Pittock. You mentioned today a couple of times about soft power and the role that presenting Scotland's culture to the world can play, not just as a good in itself, but in the exercise of soft power. I wonder, can you say a bit more about how others see us, how that's developed over the last generation in terms of how Scotland is seen culturally, but also to what ends that soft power you think might usefully be exercised?
So, thank you very much for that. I think first of all, Scotland's international brand is very well recognised, but it has remained duck to some extent. That is that both the Anholt brand and previously Anholt GfK Europa branding and the British Council research indicate no real particular movement in perception. There's some slight areas of improvement or change, but basically it's a fairly nostalgic view of Scottish culture. Now, there are opportunities in that view, and Burns Suppers have been mentioned a few times already, but actually, of course, there are quite a few big Burns Suppers in Europe and North America, which have very significant business and trade presence, and they do represent opportunities. And of course, I'm very supportive of them elsewhere as the author of the relevant report on Burns and the Scottish economy. But I think also that the inquiry which is currently being taken on local food production, for example, has got a good tourist and international markets link in terms of the demand for provenance and story attached to food and drink, which is again very much part of the traditional brand. But that said, there are things to be done with the traditional brand, a great deal. You can't ignore it. You must utilise it. But it is rather stuck. And I think that the extension, as I suggested, to research and to the cutting-edge nature of Scottish Space Strategy is a good example at the Dubai Expo. The cutting-edge nature of work in Scotland, in industry, in SMEs, in universities, to a wider audience is an important part of soft power. What are the ends of that soft power? The ends of that soft power are to not transform, but to alter the way, to extend the way in which Scotland is perceived, and to marry up more clearly Scotland's clear commitment to a modern society, to the climate emergency, and to the digital and cultural economy, with the way in which the country in general is perceived, to, as it were, modernise the Scottish brand without losing the essence of its underpinning appeal. And I think that's important, because it simply makes Scotland and the Scottish brand more influential in the world. And the more influential the Scottish brand is in the world, the more it can contribute, as in terms of having every player on the team, the more it can contribute to the UK's position internationally also.
And can I ask also, in terms of the role that the hubs play in that and other activities, how cost-effective you feel they are? I mean, there's been some political discussion and debate about whether more hubs can be justified or not. I mean, I feel they can, but how does their cost effectiveness or frugalness or otherwise compare to some other diplomatic actors who perhaps found their entertaining and architectural traditions more on the Conference of Vienna?
I think perhaps others can give chapter and verse here, but certainly Scotland is a very low spender in international sub-state actor terms, certainly in absolute terms, and depending on the state, possibly also per capita in terms of its representation. So I think what we need to ensure is there's greater transparency over what the hubs do, how they do it, and their success. I think there's some success stories from the hubs that I know of that haven't yet got through into general circulation, and that's part of what we're discussing this morning. But others may have chapter and verse on the numbers, which are certainly available. I just know Scotland's is a relatively low outlier.
So, finally, do you see, or would you have a view about whether or not there should be more hubs in the future? And is the model of co-location, you've said it's a helpful one, but is it a necessary one?
Well, I think it depends what you want to do with it. I mean, there could be more hubs in the future, and there's certainly, I can certainly think off the top of my head of areas where there could be hubs that would fit in with the trade and EU priorities. Do they have to be in the British Embassy? I think there are sometimes issues currently if they are not. One has to tread very carefully there. But if, for example, a model was taken, I thought about large city relationships, whereby there was a hub in a major city, which are very large cities, but which are not state capitals, in which a British embassy was not cited, then clearly there would be a case for the Scottish government having a separate hub there if that was the decision taken.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I move to questions from Mr. Golden, please?
Thank you, convener. And perhaps initially start with Dr. Adam Marks. Just in his submission from the Law Society of Scotland, they emphasised that they would welcome the Scottish Parliament having oversight of the decision not to align with EU law. Would you be able to expand on this issue and what parliamentary oversight you feel would be welcome and what form this would take?
Absolutely. It's a good question, and I think it's also a very challenging question. I think really the starting point is, as Kirsty has alluded to, you can use the keeping pace power or not to follow EU law. And really, as I'd sort of like to point out, I mean, the scale of what is happening in EU law on a year-to-year basis, last year, I've just dug it out, there's 1,356 legal acts were adopted in 2020 across the EU. Now, many of these will not be relevant to Scotland, trying to keep pace with EU law, and there are questions about what the objectives are within that. I think this is sort of the initial scoping point must be the sort of what is the purpose of this and what are we looking to. But what I would like to see is more information given, particularly about the sort of nature of policy in the EU to parliamentarians. And therefore, there is more obvious questions that can emerge from parliamentarians with certain interests of why decisions have been made. Because the decision to follow something could be as significant as the decision not to follow something. And so I think that is more what I was particularly starting to dig at. In terms of the processes, this could be part of the memorandum of understanding I referred to earlier. It may be that it's not particularly for this committee, because it could be something that is particularly relevant to a different committee, if it is an environmental piece of legislation or something. So I think it is that sort of scale and scope across the parliament is the sort of thing that every committee is going to have to be thinking about in the background of its work going forwards. Thank you.
Thank you. Would any of the other panel members like to comment?
I'm happy to add. I think, as Dr. Marx has said, first of all, if you're going to do this, then there's a huge amount of information gathering potentially to be done. And obviously, it's a unilateral Scottish Government decision to do that. You don't have any Scottish Government EU body to discuss that or to discuss what appropriate laws in devolved areas would be. However, there is, in fact, one shortcut on that, despite all the controversy around the Northern Ireland Protocol at the moment. Obviously, Northern Ireland, under the protocol, stays in the EU single market for goods, and so there is either already is or is going to be a process by which all relevant laws, EU laws that need to go into Northern Ireland laws or regulations, are clearly listed. So there may be a shortcut there for both the Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government. But I think this real issue is around, in terms of transparency and accountability, Dr. Marx talked about what is it for, what choices are being made, because in this huge range of legislation, some of it's not actually going to be feasible given we're outside the EU, and it's not only not going to be feasible, for instance, because of the Internal Market Act, it may be to do with regulatory structures, non-participation in various EU bodies that are relevant to overseeing EU law. So there may be therefore specific technical institutional reasons not to follow something, but there may be a whole series of political and policy and strategic choices being made, both in terms of which laws to align with, and as I've said before, how closely to align. And that's not something that should just be being done in the background, by Scottish Government and officials. So I think that's what's very important to have a full and comprehensive view of. And even if different issues will go to different committees, I think to get a sense of the overall balance is one that I would think is for your committee and is extremely important.
Thank you, Dr. Hughes. Would Professor Pittock like to come in with any additional comments? No? Okay. I'd like to just move on to a slightly different subject area, just around how Scottish elected representatives engage with the EU. The Committee of the Regions is an EU advisory body composed of locally and regional elected representatives. I would just like the panel's views, and I think I'll start with Dr. Hughes, of how and should Scottish elected representatives engage with the Committee of the Regions.
To be honest, I'm not sure what's feasible, but I think if and the other panelists may know better than me, so I won't dwell on it. If there are existing examples of non-EU member states or sub-states or regions engaging with the Committee of the Regions, then I think that would be welcome and a good idea. And you know, if you look at for instance, the way Scotland and the Scottish government has engaged with the Arctic Council, with Nordic governments, it's not, you know, it's not a full member of relevant regional bodies, but nonetheless it has managed to engage with meetings and events and so forth. So I think that is well recognised. It does have some impact. So I would to some extent disagree with the view that Scotland is only viewed through a traditional prism. There's obviously a question of balance there, but I think some of those interaction with regional bodies, and not only the EU Committee of the Regions, but that is obviously one, and we've mentioned before the Friends of Scotland group and the Scottish and the European Parliament. So I'm not sure of the detail of that, but I think definitely worth exploring.
Thank you for that contribution. Would any of the other panellists like to come in on that? Yes, okay, Dr. Marks.
Yeah, I'd just like to echo Kirsty's comments. I mean, I think it would be welcome to have any engagement possible. I think as we've sort of discussed at length before, there will be elements of prioritisation within this that will, you know, to some extent come down to this. The Committee of Regions is a very useful body in Brussels. It covers a diverse body of opinion, and this is one way you can raise issues away from some of the sort of political heat of some of the other institutions, which can be useful, particularly if you're looking to raise issues earlier in the processes. I would also echo the comments about the Friends of Scotland group. I think engaging with MEPs themselves is important. On issues that are of mutual interest to both this committee and the Scottish Government and the MEPs, where possible. I think it would be a body that is going to help fill some of the gaps that is there. So I would recommend that as well. Thanks.
Thank you. Professor Pittock.
Thank you. Just to say that very much in favour of engaging with informal groups and relevant groups such as the Arctic Council. On a technicality, the regions grouping is limited, my understanding, to EU member states, and therefore the most that could happen surely would be informal observer status. There is no EU member state represented in the European Committee of the Region, non-EU member state.
Thank you, panel. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. I have a couple of additional questions, but I'm at that point where I have to ask for concise questions and answers, if possible, please. Can I go first to Mr. Cameron?
Thank you, convener. I'll try. I've got two questions. I'll ask them as concisely as possible. The first is to ask, how do we measure success? I think that's one of the hardest things about Scotland's international footprint. How do we practically measure success? And the second question is, are the panels satisfied that there is enough coordination, particularly on thematic issues, between the various international offices and hubs that exist, as well as, I think, the Scotland Development International offices, which are also in place? Could I start with Professor Pittock?
Yes, on your second question, Deputy Convener, I think that there is good coordination, but I don't think it's altogether visible. So I think that's an issue for the issues of transparency around this committee. I'm not clear, actually, that in many of the events I've been to abroad where SDI have been represented and where sometimes the UK government, sometimes the Scottish government has been represented, that the alignment between SDI and Scottish government representation is absolutely clear and perfect. So, and on the first point, quite simply, I do success almost as many parents, but I do think we need some measures of activity which has led to successful outcomes, KPIs, if you like, about hub activity and success in driving forward trade relationships, positive research funding, that kind of thing.
Kirsty Hughes.
I think on success, you obviously have to have multiple indicators. If you're going to ask, you know, two or three people in a hub to have an immediate obvious impact on trade growth with Germany or something, that's not going to be reasonable or realistic. But I think that's why the more clarity and to some extent detail there is in European and international structures and strategies, then the easier it is to also evaluate for success. If you know what they're doing there or what they're meant to be doing there, and then you can see where it's going. Relationship building is a crucial part of all this, and that's not for the short term, it's for the longer term. But as Professor Pittock just said, you know, you can to some extent monitor that in terms of range of meetings, you know, were they with government, with business, with civil society, what areas they were in, how much do those areas match to stated priorities and so forth. And it's not really been mentioned much today, but perhaps that's telling in itself. You know, one of the two new planned hubs is in Poland, and while I can see more reasons for the one in Copenhagen, perhaps less so at first glance in terms of Poland. But again, that depends on your strategy. Is, you know, how closely is your strategy focused on trade, or is it focused on having a good spread across the EU, or is it about some of the more diaspora relationships? You know, which of the priorities are driving this, and how does that fit in the overall strategy? I think our coordination across hubs in the EU, as I said earlier, I think from what I understand of current and relatively newly restructured structures, looks good. I don't know if that's working as well internationally, but in the absence, in my view, of a clear and well thought through international strategy, then those offices will by definition to some extent be struggling, if I'm right, on the need for a renewed international strategy. And lastly, of course, the Scottish Development International shares office space with the Scottish Government Brussels office, and improvements have been made and changes to that in the last year or two, I think it is. So I don't know if that would be seen as a model or as considerable improvement. But again, if you're getting regular reporting on how these things are working and whether, for instance, you know, is the Brussels shared space working better than some other examples around the world? Is there learning going on from that and so on? So I think your questions raise more questions and answers that can perhaps come from some of those actually running these offices.
And Dr. Marks, do you have any observations?
Just briefly. I would say again, I'm struck that in the previous panelists' answers to both of your questions, transparency is the sort of word that's mentioned more times than anything. I'd echo the comments that if we had a clear strategy that is laid out in detail, then it is easier to judge what in fact is going to be the outcomes and what can be delivered. I would also suggest, as a way of perhaps helping to move forward rather than just giving questions to questions, is that in terms of looking at sort of the activities of SCDI and the success of the hubs and things, again, reporting back to you with measures would perhaps be useful. And that, of course, could perhaps be something you'd look at including in a memorandum of understanding where you to go that way. Thank you.
Ms. Boyack.
Thanks very much, Convener. Just to follow up the question Maurice Golden asked earlier about inter-parliamentary work and transparency, Dr. Marks, you commented on the need for greater transparency and accountability in inter-parliamentary relations. So just to think through, what should our priorities be as a Scottish Parliament in developing those relations? I think confederal examples were mentioned earlier, soft power comes up all the time, but I'm thinking in terms of common interest post-COP, and particularly for our committee to understand where the EU is going, Scottish Government's keeping pace aspirations. What would be your advice on where we start to make recommendations as a committee to our parliamentary colleagues?
I would start very much with the areas of common interest. I think that is the way to proceed in terms of particularly liaising and working with other parliaments, trying to find things that both you as a parliament are interested in and they are interested in will usually produce the most amount of dialogue. And I think certainly at this stage, that's what's looking for. In terms of the keeping pace power, that's slightly different in that there's a need there to know what it is the Scottish Government is also doing, so that there's a transparency aspect away from just inter-parliamentary relations. Within the UK, obviously, I think there is also wider questions about inter-parliamentary relations, which are perhaps slightly different, and considering we're short for time, I'll perhaps leave for now.
Okay, thanks. I was thinking about both of those issues because an issue that came up in our own scrutiny was the challenge of people knowing what's coming next in Europe. Because we're no longer at the table there. We have huge numbers of pieces of European legislation being developed, and it's to have a sense about where they're going so that it's not a surprise when issues finally go through the European Parliament. So just thinking about how we do a bit of forward-looking ourselves. I don't know if any of the other witnesses have a comment on that.
Simply to say, I think the Brussels hub is pivotal.
And Kirsty Hughes, in terms of inter-parliamentary foresight?
Well, I think, firstly, yes, the Brussels hub is very important, and I think, you know, does really good work in Brussels and has throughout the very difficult Brexit years of maintaining relationships, building relationships as the UK mission has to, in general, post-Brexit, finding out what's going on, sharing intelligence, obviously, with UK colleagues. But as I said earlier, in terms of the Northern Ireland Protocol, despite the current fractious discussion, that is actually, you know, can cut through some of the work and help the officials and government see what's coming up. But because there's so much, you know, you nonetheless, as a parliament, I would say, need to be very clear from the Scottish Government how they are sifting that, what the priority areas are, what the overall balance looks like. And not only, and it mustn't be, I think one of the messages is this morning, it mustn't be simply through technically whether that's being done through the keeping pace legislation. If there's a general Scottish Government aim to align with a rolling amount of EU legislation through whatever means, they should be reporting to you on that overall, with full transparency. But I mean, to me, your question also, you know, it raises a wider question. It's not only a question of aligning with or keeping pace with legislation. Well, you know, where is the big strategic direction of the EU going? You know, what from your point of view or Scottish Government's point of view are the top 5 or 10 issues? And if we're trying to think about having the best possible European strategy, which of those top 5 or 10 issues, you know, can the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament through the inter-parliamentary relations best deal with? So I think there's issues around the aligning. There are big issues around the general Scotland, Europe and Scotland international relations. And then there's the question of the Scottish Government, UK Government and inter-parliamentary relations in the context of this rather brave new post-Brexit world and the world of the trade and cooperation agreement. And I think the message again today is that much more needs to be done. There needs to be new or reformed or revised structures to improve that UK-Scotland coordination and to ensure Scotland, whether parliamentary or government, has a real a real voice and real appropriate access to different bodies, and that's not a small thing, it's a rather big thing.
That's a really helpful answer, thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Can I say thank you very much to our panel this morning, Dr. Hughes, Dr. Martz and Professor Pittock. It's been a really informative session. By way of information, we will be taking evidence on the 16th of December from the Scotland House in Brussels, London and Berlin hubs to add to our consideration of this inquiry. And also, as a committee, we have undertaken to continue a committee engagement with the presidency of the EU as it changes, as the committee has done when we were a member state going forward. But that concludes our session or an inquiry into Scottish Government's international work this morning. We now move to consideration of the draft report on the Continuity Act, draft policy statement and draft annual report. And I close the public session of this meeting.